Ching-a-ling, ching-a-ling, ching-a-ling. Ooh, whoa, you never know what the night might bring. It's the number one libido supplement for men and women's sexual health with only one tablet twice a week or as needed. You can turn your gorilla into King Kong. Why be good when you can be great? Order yours today at chingabrands.com. That's C-H-I-N-G-A-brands.com. Always free shipping. Always a good, good time.
TV 90.5 FM Lineville, JC Sports Networks.
Me, but also you. The Pharaoh fast forwards his favorite foreign film. Powder donut. Okay, what's my line?
The only line I see here on the script is get options based on your budget with the Name Your Price tool from Progressive.
Oh man, that's a tongue twister, huh? I'm sorry, I'm gonna need a few more minutes. Bulbous Walrus, the Bulbous Walrus.
The Name Your Price tool, only from Progressive.
The owl ran afoul of the comatose coxswain.
Progressive Casualty Insurance Company and Affiliates. Price and coverage match limited by state law.
With this mess, luckily, they have three. No fine print, just exceptional coverage. Three is a product of Berkshire Hathaway Direct Insurance Company. Three, no nonsense, just common sense.
USA Radio News with Lance Pry.
Senator Rand Paul, the Republican from Kentucky, said that the President Trump impeachment trial is dead on arrival, as 45 senators voted that it is unconstitutional. The vote failed in the Senate 55-45 on Tuesday after five Republican senators voted with Democrats. Senators then put the trial on pause for 2 weeks, agreeing to delay any further debate until February 9th. A federal judge on Tuesday barred the United States government from enforcing a 100-day deportation on President Biden's immigration policy. U.S. District Judge Drew Tipton issued a temporary restraining order sought by Texas, which sued on Friday against a Department of Homeland Security memo that instructed immigration agencies to pause most deportations. Two people were killed in an hours-long hostage standoff at a medical center in Austin, Texas on Tuesday night. SWAT responded to the Children's Medical Group in downtown Austin about a person entering a facility with a gun. KVUE reported the suspect appears to be a doctor. USA Radio News. Helping us understand the Trump impeachment process, USA Radio News' Tim Berg explains.
The entire Senate sworn in as jurors ahead of the second impeachment trial of former President Donald Trump. All 100 members of the upper chamber taking the oath of office, including Vermont Senator Pat Leahy, who is a presiding officer over the trial. The trial set to begin February 8th. Regarding impeaching President Trump, Republican Senator from Louisiana John Kennedy tells Fox News,
I know that common sense is illegal in Washington, D.C., but I think a fair-minded, rational person would ask Congress to vote to file a declaratory judgment action to ask the Supreme Court to rule on the constitutionality of impeaching a president who isn't president before we put the country through this.
From the USA Radio News Phoenix Bureau, I'm Tim Berg.
USA Radio News. Sports writers in America decide who gets into Cooperstown and enshrined into Major League Baseball's Hall of Fame and who doesn't. This year, many writers left their ballots blank, causing quite the stir. USA Radio News' Dan Naraki has more.
For the first time since 2013 and just
fired up and download capacity versus major cable providers 1 gig service with uploads of 35 megabits per second. Speeds vary, not guaranteed. Restrictions apply.
Ever dreamed of being a radio DJ or hosting your own show? Now here's your chance. WQEE 99 Rock the Key is giving you an opportunity to host your own show. If you'd like to get your advertising message across the thousands of listeners throughout the area, here's your chance. Hosting your own show is the way to do it. Perfect for attorneys, realtors, churches, sports talk shows, and more. Contact 678-673-6318 for further information. Host your own show.
Hey, I'm Jimmy Ellis, and I'm the pastor here at Noonan City Church. I want to thank you. You'll find as you walk through that we focus on three areas primarily. One is worship, small groups, and local missions. And our purpose is transforming lives for Jesus' sake, helping individuals experience that transformation. And we use these three areas, worship, small groups, and local missions, to help individuals experience that. I hope that as you walk through that you'll get a sense of who Noonan City Church is, and I hope that you'll come and worship with us soon. Take care, and God bless.
Hello, I'm Game Warden Charles Fallon with Georgia DNR Law Enforcement. Spending your days outdoors protecting Georgia's natural resources and serving its citizens sound inviting? If so, you might have what it takes to join the state's oldest law enforcement agency and become a Georgia Game Warden. If you're interested in wearing the gray and green, visit GADNRLE.org and click careers to see the minimum qualifications and application process. Thank you.
I'm Dr. Lewis Boynton. Please join us every Wednesday from 10 to 11 here on WQEE 99.1 for Health, Happiness, and Harmony, a show about stress management and positive psychological techniques. Hi, I'm Dr. Lewis Boynton. I'm the host of Health, Happiness, and Harmony, and I'm also a psychotherapist, so if you need some help, please come and see us. We're available for online appointments and for in-person appointments if you are corona-free. So join us here or join us. Contact me at my office, and my website is www.flourish2live.com. If you need some help, you can also find me on Psychology Today, and you can click and make an appointment and register for an appointment, and I'll schedule something, and we have appointments available immediately.
It's Zen's Day once again, and it's now time for your Health, Happiness, and Harmony Hour with your host, Dr. Lewis Boynton. His offices are located at 2.5 East Court Square, Suite 5 here in Newnan. Call him at 470-251-0167 or email him at lewisb@flourishtolive.com. It's now time for the Health, Happiness, and Harmony Hour with your host, Dr. Lewis Boynton.
Good morning. Thanks for joining us here at Health, Happiness, and Harmony. I'm Dr. Lewis Boynton. And thanks for being here. Health, Happiness, and Harmony is a show in which we talk about psychology, positive psychology. I've been talking a lot about human emotions and this idea of meeting people in person, not digitally, like to build your social intelligence, just some small things to remember. Humans are built to learn through being with people. For all of you guys who like being in the internet in the dark, watching TV or playing video games, you should go out and be with people. It's recommended that we be with non-digital entities for at least 6 to 8 hours a day, usually. Talking to them, too, would be great. You're in your room with the door closed. Eating your burrito is not count as social contact with your parents who are downstairs, sitting on the couch, watching TV, eating burritos.
Even if
they've got the best Facebook page ever, it's like a soap opera every day, something new. But human contact is good for humans. And it's really great to remember that. We're built to be humans being. Being is a gerund. It is a different verb conjugation of be, which means exist, where you are. Being is the act of existing where you are as a human. Many people would like to be cyborgs or digitally enhanced humans. This is something that people wish to do to make life easier. But remember, the more technology you've got in your body, the more surgeries, the more doctors, the more complicated things you've got to remember to do to maintain those digital things. And all things usually run on a power source that has to be changed. So please think about that. I know that from personal experience. I have several mechanical pumps and a mechanical hip that is installed in my body at this time. So I am a cyborg, and I can tell you it's not what they sell it as it's supposed to be. So it's not, especially on nice, humid, muggy, rainy days, you still have the after effects of a cyborg implant. So, but humanity is the thing, and being is part of human being. To exist, to live, to talk, to have friends, to fall in love, to get your heart broken, to go through hard times. You know, as we get more and more into this year, we're hearing more and more about economic hard times, and we're seeing more and more about, just when you look on the news today, it feels like there's a bad thing, then another bad thing. Then somebody reminds you you're paying more money for stuff you used to pay less for. Then there's a bad thing, then there's a bad thing, then there's a economic downturn thing. But all that aside, there's always something to find in your life that's going to be good for you. And you can always take time to take care of yourself. And I think we need to remember that. We all need to remember that. The goal of life is to enjoy it, to make sure that we have the things that help us to live, to not pay attention to all the things that we feel are bad, things that give us stress and anxiety all the time, but not ignore all our personal responsibilities. It's a fine balance being a human. And I think one of the more important things that we seem to be finding as less and less of a commodity is, number one, being with people, and then liking who we are, and then, you know, finally learning how to have compassion and feeling like it is not a detriment, a weakness, a liability. I keep hearing this a lot when I introduce the topic to people that I come across. Kindness is a weakness. If you're too kind, people will take advantage of that. If you're kind, you get hurt. Another good one is, what is the point? Another one is, you got to have an edge. Another one is, got to keep your hustle going. All those things are good and fine, and humans are very innovative and should hustle and have protections like defenses for people who might hurt you. But I still think that we should be able to understand, find, and be able to have this thing called empathy. Empathy is the ability to try and understand somebody's experience. Technically, it means to step into someone's experience. The psychologist Carl Rogers, in his book on becoming a person and person-centered therapy, goes into these ideas of what it is to be mentally well, what it is to live a good life, and what it is to actually get a great benefit from the therapy that you attend. And in that book, he talks about, he writes a lot to the therapist in that situation. And he really, it seems like he's instructing people on how to be good therapists. But the way he writes it, it's hard to understand that. So you've got to read it a couple times. But when I was looking over it again after, you know, I do it once every little while, I saw this thing where he talked about empathy, and he said, every once in a while, you need to risk stepping into somebody else's experience. And that sounds like it's far-fetched, like it's telepathic or kind of like a psychic, but really it's understanding what somebody else is going through and feeling some kind of emotion because you've felt that same emotion before. We're built like with the ability to do this. Human beings are. We're kind of unique because we have this prefrontal cortex. Other mammals, I believe, have this, but we have a prefrontal cortex which allows us to be creative, to make decisions, to create new things, to imagine new things. We also have many, many systems in our brain that allow us to envision something, to make believe, if you want to say, to have a fantasy, to imagine. And when we can imagine somebody else's stuff and what they're going through, it allows us, through these things we're still studying called mirror neurons, to kind of get a reflection of what that would be like for you. Some people have this in great doses. They have this great amount of primary and secondary empathy. Some people don't use it because it is very painful and it takes a lot of energy from you. But this idea of empathy is that we as humans, by spending time with humans, can learn how to like humans. That makes sense, doesn't it? Like if you hang out with someone, you get to know them, you might like them. So the reverse is true as well. If you don't spend a lot of time with people, if you don't spend a lot of time thinking about people, if all you see is images of people, digital images, or little small videotapes, or whatever it is you think, and those images don't have good representation or associations with them, you're going to get a different idea of people. It's going to be harder to have empathy, too. Another thing is humans, in order to thrive in this world, humans really need to have meaning in their lives. Meaning is as much a part of compassion as empathy, but it's something that we choose to believe in. It's something that we feel like we're moving towards. It's the thing in life that gives us this really special experience. Uh-oh, I've said too much. Now people are trying to... It's a Timothy Leary moment. They're expanding their consciousness, and the consciousness police are coming to get me. Shut it down. We want people to be compliant and quiet. Break out your phones, folks. We got a new video on Google. Right? It's what the consciousness police wants you to do. Compliant and quiet. Obey the rules. There's so many like post-apocalyptic movies about that, you know, but they where the subliminal messaging is placed inside media so that people are compliant and they follow the rules. And next thing you know, it's a whole Soylent Green. For those of you older who know who are Charlton Heston fans, it's a whole Soylent Green experience, if you know what I mean. But if we want to avoid that, if we want to make the world a better place, you can start with you. You can understand that you can feel and care for people, and it's okay. It's actually part of a lot of spiritual practices. I grew up as a Christian. I went to Catholic stuff. I kind of got out of that later on. Then I started going to Baptist, evangelical stuff. I've even been to tent revivals. When I got in the South, my friends hooked me up with these really cool tent revivals where there's a preacher, and he gets up there, and he's like, amen, 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 and amen. And he's really talking about stuff, and he's getting people really worked up. I've seen all that. I've taken, you know, religion and philosophy classes, quite a few, you know. So I've got a pretty broad vision of what spiritual practices are. But on the bottom, I think I say this, but Karen Armstrong says it eloquently. Most major spiritual practices have this thing called the Golden Rule. And the Golden Rule is basically how she defines compassion. And it's treat others as you would treat yourself. I know for some people who don't treat themselves very well, that may not work, but basically what it says is love you and who you are. Love the fact that you're a unique being created in this moment in time. There's never going to be anything exactly like you. You are individual, unique, special. But remember, there are also many other unique, special, miraculously created beings who are in this with you. Some of those could actually help you. Some of those may hurt you. Some of those are you may never know. But if you keep trying to practice that basic rule to do unto others as you would have them do unto you, or to love others as you would love yourself, that little small rule can help you to have more compassion in your life. And I think if we want to understand what it means to be a being, we always have to revisit what humanity really is. You know, sometimes this world feels like it's unsafe. Sometimes it feels like people around us are unsafe. Sometimes it feels that way. And I'm saying this because not only have I felt that sometimes, but I know a lot of other people who I talk to have felt that sometimes. And I've read lots of research and papers on asking people survey questions about how they feel. And the thing is, humans can feel safe and feel like they belong in certain places in the world and eventually work to a place where you feel good about who you are and good about others around you. And you get to feel safe and like you belong. Sometimes it's harder than others because not everybody is born into the world equally financially okay or equally nutritionally balanced or equally put in a good experience, but all of us have the opportunity to learn, to grow, and to change. And it's very hard sometimes, and sometimes it's very easy. Sometimes we can catch something just in a small period of our life. We can catch a small moment, and it can change everything for us. And I really believe in that. I think if we're compassionate, and we're practicing our skills with people, and we believe there are good people out there, and we believe that our lives can be enriched by coming in contact with others, I think it'll help us feel better about the world. You know, every time I look on TV and see the news, it's an election season. So when there's an election season, you hear, we're so divided. The nation in the United States has never been more divided, but that division can be changed. It can shift back to where people just didn't really care about politics. It wasn't such a big deal. You didn't identify yourself. You know, it's not part of your identity what color you are, you know, in your political views. It wasn't like that all the time. There was a time when people would wait until the election season. They would watch the commercials, and whichever commercial they liked and whoever had views like them, they'd vote on them, and they wouldn't really talk about it. They wouldn't share about it because it was their private business. They would share about it with their family, but not about with others. Now it seems more people are hesitant to share their views because they feel like whatever view they have, they're going to get some kind of punishment from whoever they share it with. So that right there is helping us to be divided. But I really think that compassion brings people together. I think if you could see somebody as another human, that helps you to understand that maybe some of the things they have had happen to them in their life have affected the way they act now, you know? It's also the same relevance for you. As you develop your being and you learn how to live and you learn how to grow up and you learn how to do things in your life, you have to develop a balanced sense of achievement. You have to work on rewarding yourself and correcting yourself. You have to work on loving yourself enough to tell yourself the truth that maybe something you're doing in your life isn't really good for you, or it's hurting you more than it's helping you. If you love yourself enough, it becomes easier to recognize when you are in situations that aren't healthy for you. And I know that word's kind of overused, health and mental health and all that stuff, but life is designed, and most philosophers write about this, life is designed for humans to find something that makes them feel like they have purpose, like they matter. My friend Richard LaFleur writes a lot about mattering. Like they make a difference in their part of the world, even for one person. Some people feel like they need a great giant change to make them feel like they matter, like lots of money or influence on the internet. Other people think that they already matter and that their life is really good and complete, simply within their family sometimes, that everything's okay. The job they do is great. They really like it. They matter because people know who they are. They matter to themselves because they value who they are. I think this is a great sort of ending point for self-compassion, or maybe even a beginning point to get yourself to the place where you matter. So I guess my point is, if you want to be human, you've got to learn more about compassion. And I know people say, what do you mean? I'm human already. And I mean more, I guess, exploring more deeper levels of humanity. And I know that sounds very, what do they call it, woo-woo? It sounds very woo-woo when I say that. But really, human is an incredible experience for you. It's a unique experience that only you can do. I remember when I was very, very sick and I was going to therapy. I had somebody, I think it was a counselor, tell me, he's like, you spend the most time in your head. You spend 100% of your time with you. So you need to really be nice to you. Otherwise, all that time you're not nice, it's kind of a bad time in your life. And that's time you're never going to get back. Life is finite. It comes to an end. Steve Jobs says this really inspirational speech. I think he was doing a speech for a college. He was doing a commencement speech, but it was towards the end of his life. But he talks a lot about how when you realize that your life has a limited end or a limited meaning, that it makes you feel more alive than ever, if you want. It can also make you feel pretty down and depressed, but it really, for him, it said it made him feel more alive. It made him feel like he had purpose. He was driven. He was looking for something. It made him feel like his life was special and unique, and it increased, I guess, his self-worth. For a man who was worth a lot and thought a lot of himself, often described as not a nice person, but he was able to, like, see that truth, that life can be and be made into something special. I think for me, it's that idea of what can I do for me to help my life get better? I get that question asked a lot in my particular profession. It's very unique because not a lot of people ask that in other professions. They don't go to the doctor and say, how to make my life much better? How do I find meaning and purpose? How do I get over this sadness? Well, they do that sometimes. The doctor gives them medication. But for me, I tell people the goal is to become more socially intelligent, to participate in your life and find compassion so you can help yourself to live a life that flourishes. Flourishing is the idea that, you know, we can live a successful life. We can thrive in all our own humanness and enjoy things as they come. That we work to solve our problems, but we also have what we call a good life overall. So, in other words, we have health, happiness, and harmony. So when you get to this place where you can have self-compassion and you really start caring for yourself, you can start to begin to practice compassion. I think you've got to get to a place first, though, where you love and care for yourself. And that place sometimes is really hard to get to. And sometimes it's really easy. But the goal is to put certain practices in your life that'll help you find compassion for you. We've talked a lot about this on the show. I think I've done shows on different kind of skills to have self-compassion. I think we've done shows on forgiveness. We've done shows on acceptance. We've done shows on mindfulness. We've done shows on empathy. And self-empathy is kind of a start, but also developing empathy is another way to give yourself some actual practice in learning how to care about people. Empathy is not really love. Empathy is more like an understanding. It's like a skill. Most phenomenologists and lots of psychologists believe this is like a primary way of people communicating with each other. The skills that you develop in a social setting or in the social world, as some people call it, help you to engage and relate to people as you see them, help you to be creative in how you respond, and help you to understand the sort of social normals in life. I think sometimes we take that for granted, you know. Sometimes we, with the advances of technology, I feel sometimes we're also losing some of those skills that we used to have when we didn't have this technology, and that the social world has really changed because of technology, you know. So if we're working on our own self-compassion, our own things, maybe we need to look and examine our habits and what we do in the social world. And maybe, well, for me, I always look at how much am I using technology versus spending time with other people. And that one's a tough question because the world right now is very busy for most people. Things seem like they're often quite important when we hear bad news. Everything, at least to me. But also, people seem to have bigger, more stressful problems, at least as far as I hear in my world. And this is a hard place to learn how and to understand what compassion can do for you. But I'll explain that when you're in a world where you feel unsafe, and you can make it safer by just simply believing that it's safer, it kind of helps you to lower your stress level. There's a lot of techniques to lower your stress level, but I think learning how to have a little bit of compassion and understanding for you can help you to let go of some of your burdens. I think if you have a little bit of self-compassion or understanding for yourself, you're going to know your limits. I think knowing your limits and being able to accept them and being able to set a good limit or a boundary for yourself is another form of self-compassion that can help you live a really good life, you know? And it just, all these topics that I keep coming up with today, it seems like I'm a little bit rambled, but they really do connect. It's all about being better at being a person. I can remember times when I was in a really big spiritual group, and the underlying lessons would be to do good and stay away from doing bad, you know? And it feels to me now that there's so much information out there now, it's hard to know if there's a good, bad, what is the gray area? What's the foundation of the truth? And how do you get there in the world? And I think my overall belief is that if we just keep striving and going and we take care of us, which is a form of self-care, which is self-compassion, we can grow more and feel more stable in our own lives. And as we develop this self-compassion, we can learn how to have this, like, caring for ourselves without going too far, you know? There is a point where you can protect yourself too much. Your defenses can get too strong, and it's not self-compassion, but it's like more like self-seclusion. This is very easy to do in our world today. We can really get wrapped up in things that are not associated with people. We can really get pulled in many directions because of technology. And we can get moved around. So it feels like life is going so fast, we don't have time to do anything. I've just been there this week. The more and more we put on ourselves, the harder and harder it is to take stuff off. The more and more things we work through, the easier it is for us to understand and like and love and care for ourselves. If you have your own set of things that you do to take care of yourself, I would say now's the time to really keep them in practice. Summer's always a great time to understand, like, how do I take a rest from work? How do I find a good spot where I can re-energize myself? This is a part of self-compassion that can be really important to you. But Karen Armstrong writes about that, and she writes a whole chapter in her 12 Steps to a Compassionate Life. When she talks about compassion, she says many, many things. She writes a great chapter on some of the steps you can do. And she ends it up with getting, right after that chapter on self-compassion, she gets into empathy. And I think empathy is really important to understand. I've been reading a lot about it. I think it's something in humans that we have. I actually believe that some people have quite a bit of empathy. They just don't want to use it because they have been hurt. There's a big belief that some people don't take care of themselves because, and I'm not saying it scientifically, but I guess I'm just stating my opinion. I believe that empathy helps us to stabilize ourselves in the world. It helps us to see other people as human beings, as not greater than or less than us, but is equal to us as part of our species, as part of our, you know, neighborhood, as part of our community, as part of the shared history, as going through some of the same things we're going through, as experienced things. I know empathy is hard to understand for a lot of people, but there are lots and lots, and every human has capacity for this. It's just a matter of practicing this thing called secondary empathy. Now, when I first began the show, I talked about humanness and human being. I talked a little bit about self-compassion and compassion, and it seems like I'm going and mattering in the world. And I'm going all over because my brain is filled with these ideas of humanity lately. I've been studying and researching a lot on these so many different things that my head is just sort of letting out ideas about compassion and self-compassion. I feel like it's a little bit scattered, so I'm going to center myself a little bit and just say to you, life is really meant for enjoyment, and life is really limited. But I think for me, pursuing these certain things, empathy, compassion, self-compassion, makes it much more enjoyable, and it makes you enjoy all the people in your life. The reason why we have these abilities is somewhere, somehow, through evolution, through trying to be safe and belong. We develop these skills so we can expand our sort of communities, so we can feel safe and belong with different people. So we can develop these essential skills of taking care of ourselves so we can live longer and manage our lives better. And when you look at the processes related to health, happiness, and harmony, a lot of them involve in lowering your stress, reducing your activities, making your life balanced. And a lot of those things we do naturally, but sometimes it seems we need a little help. And that's where compassion, empathy can really help you. Sometimes we need to offer help to others. That's where compassion for others and empathy can help you as well. And all these things really do matter and make a difference. At least I think so. I could give so many examples of people who have really helped me in my life who didn't even know that they were helping me. People I might not know. People I might not ever talk to again. I can remember a couple of times just traveling, and my fellow travelers, we'd be stuck in an airport or waiting for a flight, and people would do small, kind things. People would offer and give directions. People would sometimes, you know, not respond. But for the most part, I've found that when I travel to other places, people are generally kind as around my house. You know, some people are really kind. Some people are very closed. And some people are extremely suspicious of you because you're different. But I realize that if I just try to keep an open mind and practice this thing that I call a little bit of skeptical optimism, I try and look for the best solutions for me within reason. When I talk about compassion and self-compassion, I do have a tendency to say and speak about people being open-minded. Not everybody can be, but I guess you have to find your own compassion for yourself to understand what your limits are and your boundaries are for this. If you've ever been hurt by somebody or somebody's broken your trust, if you've ever been victimized or abused, it's going to be much harder to do these things, to find compassion even for yourself. Lots of people I know who have been abused or hurt or really violently abused for years and have suffered from trauma. Sometimes trauma could be even accidents or majorly traumatic events like surgeries or painful events or emotionally damaging events, or sometimes even, you know, physically being violated or hurt. These things really kind of break into your compassion skills, because it's hard to trust. And if you don't trust the environment, don't feel like you belong, it's very hard to stay where you're at. I mean, it's very, very hard to stay where you're at, because you're always having triggers compare this event to something that happened in the past. It's very hard to see people and their experiences the same when you feel your experience is threatened. It's very hard to have empathy for others when you've experienced such great loss or great trauma. It's hard to understand that. It's hard to get through that sometimes because you don't feel like anybody can have empathy for you because you don't have any kind of caring for yourself. Some people, after experiencing some kind of event, feel as though their trauma has done something to them, changed them, broken them. Some people are writing about this now. They call it a moral injury, something they have done against their sort of ethical moral code has caused them great anguish and has caused them not to like who they are and not to have compassion for who they are, not to forgive themselves and not to be able to drop whatever's going on. The symptoms for a moral injury are very similar to post-traumatic stress disorder. Some would say that people who have moral injury could look like they have post-traumatic stress disorder, but it may not be as severe as that. They may not have the relived trauma, but they may have the feeling of hatred and loathing for themselves. Deeper traumas, problems with compassion, problems with self-compassion, problems with empathy are things that you can try to work on your own, but if you have such great difficulty that you don't feel anything for people, that you feel like you can't ever love, or you can't love or trust people, then maybe you can go and get some help to learn how to practice having compassion. Therapy sometimes is a modeling of behavior, but most of all, therapy sometimes is a practice of what a relationship looks like when you can be yourself, be accepted as you for who you are, no different, no understanding, no face masks, no masks, no coverings, no defensive shield, but accepted for you as a human, for you and your own being. When you feel that safety, you can usually work through some other stuff. And sometimes we as humans have a tendency to not work on things, especially if you don't care about yourself. If you don't feel like this stuff is valuable, if you don't feel like love is valuable, if you don't feel like loving other people is valuable, if you don't feel like compassion is this ultimate, it's just sort of caring about something or someone just because they exist, just because they're in front of you, just because they're the same species as you, or even, you know, the Buddhists go all the way to anything that has life. So technically, if we make a robot that becomes conscious, the Buddhists would not kill that robot because that life is valuable. That's a whole debate and a whole show in itself. But the truth is, if you have a hard time with compassion, you have a hard time developing it, know that you can with work. And the work is just seeing a therapist or a licensed clinical social worker, talking about things and working on some practices to undo whatever defense has caused you to sort of turn off your empathy or shut down your compassion or not like who you are, feel, you know, kind of ashamed of something you did or guilty about something you did or hurt over something that somebody else did to you that you can't forgive. Forgiveness is a tool of compassion, and forgiveness is a tool for all humans to kind of figure out ways to let things go. Quite often we spend most of our lives building and stacking and holding, seeking out threats, because we're designed to seek out threats and we're designed to predict 5 seconds in the future, and we all have our own set of experiences that create who we are. But if we lose consciousness, compassion, if we lose compassion, if we lose empathy, life often feels like it's just a set of actions, that you're simply existing. Sometimes it even feels like you're stuck in one place, you know? There used to be this Dunkin' Donuts commercial, and I think I've said this. This is like my 100th time I've said this on a show. There used to be this Dunkin' Donuts commercial, and it was kind of emblematic of the world. Charlie Chaplin does this really funny movie about, you know, the factory where he gets caught in these wheels and gears, and he just gets run through the gears. And it's kind of symbol of like that same just existing, just getting up, going to work. The Dunkin' Donuts commercial is the guy, alarm goes off, he gets dressed, he goes, time to make the donuts. And then it shows it repeated over and over and over and over and over and over again. And the truth is, sometimes life can feel like that. What does compassion give you? It gives you the ability to get yourself out of that rut, to do new things, to take care of yourself. Maybe life feels like that because you're tired. Maybe life feels like that because you're working too much. Maybe life feels like that because you're unhappy in your life and you've got to make some changes. And when I say changes, it doesn't mean change everything. It means maybe small changes, like see the world as a good place. Find gratitude in the things you have. Understand, you know, a life can be sometimes just existing, but you also can change that to make it a life in which you can be pursuing your own goals. You can be living to create some kind of new meaning for your life. You can be feeling good about who you are and safe in your world, the world around you. You can have friends and family you care about and have good relationships with them. This sounds like an impossible dream sometimes, but it's possible. There are millions and billions of people. And the hard thing to understand here is that money isn't as important in these things as you would think. Sometimes people care for you because they really like you. And sometimes you care for people because you really like and love them. And sometimes you can, you know, find a place where you really think that you can do something important and add to the world in some way. It could be a business. It could be a really cool, like, YouTube influencer channel to save the planet. You know, like that. Isn't that girl from Sweden the one that sailed across the ocean? The environment, Greta something? But I mean, you can add to the world or you can just live in the world. But it's much better when you're existing and you feel good within your own existence. And if you've ever had something wrong or bad and you can't get past that, that's when you really need to get to and go to see someone. And I'm not just pushing therapists because I'm a therapist. You know, this isn't a long time. What do they call those? Those infomercial? It's not an infomercial. It's really just something to say that, you know, quite often we don't look at tools that are staring us right in the face. I do that all the time. I'll be looking for a hammer and it's sitting on top of my tool chest. And I'm digging in all the drawers looking for a hammer, and it's right in front of me. Sometimes the answer's right in front of you. Sometimes it's easy as thinking, you know, I just need to change a few things in my life, and it'll be better. Or sometimes it's like, you know, I've been depressed for like 2 years. This whatever COVID thing knocked me out. It made me feel bad. Never quite recovered from it. It makes me feel a little burnt out, and the stress of going through COVID has made me worn out, and now I'm feeling like life is kind of, you know, stale, stagnant. But you can change that in a short period of time. Some people have things that happened to them in the past, and they just hold on to those resentments. As you hold on to anger and hold on to things that cost you in life, things that weren't fair, things that you were wronged, unjust things in the world, sometimes you personally will get a resentment. Holding on to that longer and longer and longer just costs you. Humans are designed to hold on to, think about, talk about, take responsibility, forgive, let go. That's what we're designed to do with our emotions. Quite often we don't learn that. Quite often we don't experience that, except with quick things like, oh, that coffee was terrible, and then you forget about it for the rest of your life. Or, oh, that coffee was great, and then you go back there all the time. Or, oh, that ice cream was fantastic, and you go back. Or, oh, that ice cream was terrible, and you never go back. Those are short examples of seeing something, talking about it, letting it out, letting go, moving past it. More and more people are holding things because we just, maybe it's you just don't have time, or maybe it's just you, that's what you like to do because it gives you power. I will be honest, compassion and love give you power. Kindness gives you power, but anger also gives you power. Not a really good power, and it's short-lived. Hate gives you power, but it mostly gives you power through fear, which really is kind of a, it's kind of a different way to get power, but we'll admit that. It's much easier on the human body to have compassion, to have love, to have caring, to have mercy, to have forgiveness. It's much easier on us. It's less stressful if you don't hold things. And I think that the scientific evidence is proving the less stress we have in our lives, the more we take care of ourselves, and the better we feel the condition of our life is. Those are all really subjective things. Although we all do need to survive, and we do need places to live, and we do need food to eat, there are lots of things in our lives we think we need and we don't. And there are lots of things in our lives that we ignore that we really need to be taken care of, right? All humans do this. I'm just as bad as the next human, but what I really like to point out is that it is possible to do things to improve your life, especially psychologically. And it doesn't have to cost you, it can add to your life. And sometimes the things you learn by getting help can really help change the direction of your life and make it a life worth living. And I guess that's my point. And the goal of all this is to have a life that's filled with health, which is something that you can have. Even if you have an illness, you can have times where you're healthy. Even if you're out of shape, you can get in shape. Even if you feel depressed, you can become happy and have health. Happiness is sort of a thing that you build. It's a thing you work for. It's not a one-shot joy. It's a set of things you practice. These are called virtues. Things like love, honesty. Today's show is about practicing self-love and love for others. And then harmony. Once you get done doing all these things, you can feel a sense of peace and calm and relaxation. You can feel like life is good. You don't have anything on your plate. You've taken care of everything. It's time to take a break. Just like McDonald's said, you deserve a break today. Not at McDonald's, though. Not sponsored by McDonald's. They turn me down. No. But the goal really in life is to enjoy it, to make it full and rich and deep, to plan. There's this new show called The Man Who Fell to Earth. It's on Showtime. But this last episode was really great, and I just want to say the last thing. He said that if you can find meaning in a moment, that moment can become eternal. The meaning is up to you, and the moment is up to you. But you can make your life deeper, richer, and more available to you if you take care of yourself, be in contact with others, and find those moments of meaning every single day. Because that's what life's about, to enjoy the miracle of life. In AA, they always say the joy is in the journey. It's not the destination. Because we all kind of have the same destination, but we don't all have the same journey. And I hope yours is filled with more health, happiness, and harmony. I'm Dr. Lewis Boynton, and I'm going to end it right there. Thanks for joining us here on 99.1 WQEE, the place where we are more compassionate than any other radio station in the 50-mile radius from us. Hope you have a great day.
Ching-a-ling, ching-a-ling, ching-a-ling. Ooh, woo, you never know what the night might bring. It's the number one libido supplement for men and women's sexual health with only one tablet twice a week or as needed. You can turn your gorilla into King Kong. Why be good when you can be great? Order yours today at chingabrands.com. That's C-H-I-N-G-A-brands.com. Always free shipping. Always a good, good time.
At Kroger, we believe it takes the right team to bring you the freshest produce. That's why we partner with farmers who grow only the best. And that level of teamwork means better, fresher options time and time again. Working with farmers is what it takes to be fresh for everyone. Kroger, fresh for everyone.
And now you'll find more ways to save on your favorites. When you download digital coupons, you can use up to 5 times in one transaction. Kroger, fresh for everyone.